السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله، الحمد لله وكفى، وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه وبارك وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا، وبعد. قال الله تعالى بعد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ما لكم لا ترجون لله وقارا وقد خلقكم أطوارا. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: أدبني ربي فأحسن تأديبي. وأيضا قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم: الدين كله أدب، أو كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم. حمدا ومصليا ومتوكلا على الله، وبعد. Respected brothers and elders, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for blessing us with this opportunity to come today to perform our Salatul Jum'ah. I hope and pray Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept our coming, and may Allah reward us both in dunya and in akhirah. There is no stage in the life of a person, and in particular in the life of a mu'min and a believer, that he can become complacent with his own progress and achievement. No time this can happen. The effort to better ourselves, the effort to improve ourselves, is unending. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَعْبُدْ رَبَّكَ حَتَّى يَأْتِيَكَ الْيَقِينَ. Continuously worship, continuously obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala until death overpowers you. When a person has the passion and the desire to better himself, then he would learn from all circumstances in life, whether it be positive or negative. Everything will leave him impressed, whether the situation is one of prosperity or one of adversity. A positive thinker finds an opportunity in every difficulty, and a negative thinker finds a difficulty in every opportunity. Again, a positive thinker, one who thinks positively, such a person, he finds an opportunity. He finds a chance. He finds an opportunity in even difficult situations. And a negative thinker, one who thinks negatively, and he will find a difficulty even in every good opportunity. Someone asked the great Sayyidina Luqman alayhi salam, the wise Luqman alayhi salam, that you are so wise, you are so famous, where did you get all of this from? How did you achieve all of this in life? And he said, I learned all of this from those who lacked them. I learned them from those who lacked them. He said, every time I would see someone doing something wrong, someone doing an evil act that looks wicked, that looks despicable, that looks or may seem unpleasant, then I would avoid that act. Someone doing something wrong, العقل تكفيه الإشارة. For an intelligent person, signs are even enough. So you see somebody doing something wrong, you would not go and do the same. You would not put your hands in the fire to be burnt, but you will avoid it. So he said, when I looked at something evil, when I looked at the faults and the flaws of others, I better myself. I make myself better. But in our situation today, in our circumstances today, it is the reverse. When we see the faults and the flaws of others, then we latch on to those things and we start with propaganda. And when that happens, we do not learn anything from that circumstances. We do not learn anything from that. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Adabani Rabbi fa ahsana ta'dibi." Today I'm talking about good mannerism. How, what kind of mannerism we should have in life. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Adabani Rabbi fa ahsana ta'dibi." My Allah molded me. My Allah fashioned me. My Allah taught me manners. My Allah left nothing short in molding me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala molded me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fashioned me. In another hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Ad-deenu kulluhu adab." This deen that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to us, this precious, valuable deen that Allah has given to us, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, another name of deen is mannerism, is manners, is akhlaq. Now what is the level of respect we owe to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Do you know we owe respect to Allah? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a complaining manner says in the Quran, "Ma lakum لا ترجون لله وقارا ما لكم لا ترجون لله وقارا." What is the matter with you, O people, that you show no regard and no respect for your Allah? You would disobey Allah, Allah's commands openly, violate the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala openly. This is showing no respect and no regard for Allah. How did Anbiya, Prophets alayhi salatu wa taslimat, remember, they were chosen people by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How did they show respect for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Ibrahim alayhi salam, Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam, he introduces Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the tyrant king of the time, Nimrud. And hear how he introduces Allah. Alladhi khalaqani fahuwa yahdeen. My Allah is the one who created me and guided me. My Allah is the one who created me. Just as how Allah has created me, Allah has created you, and Allah has created everything else existing. So, Alladhi khalaqani. My Allah is the one who created me, and after created me, fayahdeen. Allah guided me. Then he continued by saying, Walladhi huwa yut'imuni wa yasqeen. It is that same Allah who nourished me and sustained me, and perchance, if I become sick. Hear what he's saying. Perchance, if I become sick, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is kind enough to cure me. فَإِذَا مَرِضْتُ فَهُوَ يَشْفِينَ. If by chance, perchance, I fall ill, I become sick, then who cures me? That same Allah who created me, that same Allah who guided me, that same Allah who sustains me, that same Allah who feeds me, that same Allah who gave me that sickness, that same Allah is kind enough to give me that cure. Just as prosperity comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, adversity also comes from Allah. Look at the respect of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ibrahim alayhi salam did not choose to attribute the quality of sickness to Allah. Although it is Allah who makes a person sick. But he did not attribute that quality and that sifat of sickness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala simply because that by itself gives off a flavor of unpleasantness. It gives off a flavor of unpleasantness. So Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam opted to say that when I become sick, فَإِذَا مَرِثْتُ, look, he changed the entire usloob of the conversation. What was it before? الَّذِي خَلَقَنِي فَهُوَ يَهْدِي. It is Allah who created me and Allah who guided me. Who feed me, nourish me, and give me to drink. Now when it comes to sickness, what did he say? فَإِذَا مَرِثْتُ. When I become sick. He did not say when Allah makes me sick. Look at it. Look at the respect. He did not say when Allah makes me sick. He said when I become sick, then it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is kind enough to give me shifa and cure me. Our circumstances and our condition is such that we attribute adversity to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when it comes to prosperity, we attribute it to ourselves. Negative situation, oh Allah put this upon me. Allah put this upon me. Positive comes, oh this is because of my own achievements in life. At least we should do this much, have the decency to say that if adversity comes from Allah, then we should also attribute the quality of prosperity to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We all have children in life. We all have children. If someone asks your child or your son, who is your father? And your son says, my father is the one who beats me up. My father is the one who always gets angry at me. This is how your child is introducing you to other people in a negative way. What did he say? My father is the one who's your dad? Oh, my dad is the one who always beats me. My dad is the one who always gets angry at me. Now, how would you feel when you hear something like that? Negativity is coming from your child about you. Huh? Negativity. So you will feel bad. Your heart will bleed with pain. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Anbiya alayhim salam, they were such that they never attribute any negative quality to Allah. They always attribute positivity to Allah. And let me ask you a question at this time. Do we judge Allah by what Allah has given us? Or do we judge Allah by what Allah haven't given us? How do we judge Allah? Again, do we judge Allah by what Allah has given to us? Or do we judge Allah by what Allah haven't given to us? This is what we need to understand. Now, there are certain sha'air of Islam, certain symbols of Islam that it is mandatory for us to respect. To respect. For example, one of the sha'air of Islam is the Kaaba, Baytullah, right? We all respect Kaaba. We all respect the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another sha'air of Islam is the Haramain. It's the two haram. We respect highly the two haram. Another sha'air is Maqam Ibrahim. وَاتَّخِذَ مِن مَقَامِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ مُصَلَّى. These are all sha'air of Allah. Another sha'air of Allah is the masjid of Allah. Every masjid of Allah is a sha'air of Allah. Another sha'air of Allah is the Qur'an. And every ayah of the Qur'an is a symbol of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What Allah tells us, لَا يَمَسُّهُ إِلَّا الْمُطَحَّرُونَ, that we should not touch the Qur'an unless in a state of purity, right? Unless in a state of purity. The adhan is a sha'air of Allah. The adhan. What do we do when we hear the adhan? Do we respond to the adhan? What did Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tell us to do when we hear the adhan? He says, repeat what the muadhin says, right? Repeat what the muadhin says. And after the adhan, you make the dua. Because duas are accepted after the adhan. And if you make that dua and you ask shafa'ah, an intercession for me after the adhan, then behold that I will intercede for you on the day of qiyamah. But what do? We talk.
At the time of Adhan, we can hear Adhan going on and we still continue our conversation. We would not stop talking. So are we respecting the sha'air of Allah there? I saw a clip, someone sent it to me today, that the Prime Minister of India, the PM, the Prime Minister of India, Hindu fella, he was given a talk to a huge gathering. And while talking, while giving his speech, he heard the Adhan close by. What did you think he did? A non-Muslim. You think he continued his speech? I can show you the clip right now. It's in my phone. He stopped speaking. He took his mic and he put it down. And he told the people, calm down. The Adhan is going on. This is what he did. He stopped talking. He stopped giving his lecture. Whatever campaign he was doing, he stopped. Because the Adhan was going out on. Out of respect for the Adhan. Today we do not respect Adhan. We do not respect the Mu'adhineen. The people who call the Adhan. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam make dua for them. Allahumma ghfir lil Mu'adhineen. Allahumma ghfir lil Mu'adhineen. Allahumma ghfir lil Mu'adhineen. Oh Allah, forgive them. Forgive them. Forgive them. But we think of the Adhan and the job of giving Adhan is to as a very low something. Below my prestige. Below my position. But this is a sha'air of Islam. Quran is being recited sometimes, you know, and I get very angry that when I go to gatherings, you know, they tell you to recite Quran to quiet the people. People are talking and making noise. Go and recite Quran. As if Quran should be used to quiet people talking. This is complete disrespect to Quran. A couple of weeks ago, I went to a Khatm al-Quran program where one child became a hafiz. And they were doing a program for this child. And I had to give a talk. And Quran was recited and mashallah, everybody was talking. Everybody was talking. No one was listening to the Quran. And when the men stopped talking, the women continued talking. Their conversation never stopped. This is a sha'ail of Islam. And this is how we respect the Quran. This is how we respect it. لا يمسه إلا المطهرون. When Umar radiallahu anhu, when he accepted Islam and he had beaten his sister and his brother-in-law and he wanted to touch the Quran with the ayats طه ما أنزلنا عليك القرآن لتشقى. These were the ayats of the Quran of Surah Al-Taha. His sister was reciting. He wanted to hold the Quran and see what they were learning. His sister told him, you cannot touch this Quran unless and until you take a shower and you take a bath. How many people today, we have the Quran in our cars, hang in our inside window, right? And the tasbih is hanging in the window, and the music is blasting away. And because of the blasting of the music in the car, the tasbih is moving, and the Quran is moving in the car. MashaAllah, my car has a tasbih hanging. My car has a small Quran hanging. My car has Allah hanging. And the music is blasting away in my car and is moving because of the music. And this is how we respect the Quran. This is how we respect the word of Allah. This is what happens, my dear respected brothers. What Allah says, وَمَن يُعَذِّمْ شَعَائِرَ اللَّهِ إِنَّهَا مِن تَقْوَى الْقُلُوبِ إِنَّهَا مِن تَقْوَى الْقُلُوبِ. One who respects the sha'air, the symbols of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is from the piety of the heart. From the piety of the heart. Let this give a reflection of our respect to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Respect of the personality of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What Allah says in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَرْفَعُوا أَسْوَاتَكُمْ فَوْقَ صَوْتِ النَّبِيِّ. Do not raise your voice over the voice of the Nabi. لَا تُقَدِّمُوا بَيْنَ يَدَيِ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهِ. Sahaba never speak to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a high tone. Some of them would never look at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in his face directly when they would speak to him out of request. Out of respect. One Sahabi, Sayyidina Uthman radiallahu anhu, he asked one Sahabi, you know, are you older or Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is older than you?
Here's the question. Are you old? Sorry. Are you older than the Nabi of Allah? Or the Nabi of Allah is older than you? Hear what was the answer of this Sahabi. Very unique. He said, Huwa akbaru minni wa ana asinnu minhu. Those who understand Arabic will know this. Huwa akbaru minni wa ana asinnu minhu. Meaning, I am older than the Prophet of Allah, but he is elder than me. I'm older to him maybe in age, but he is elder. He is elder to me. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, during the time of his illness, you know, he had appointed Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu to lead the salah. And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he led about 17 salah during the days of the sickness of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And one day while he was leading the salah, Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, when he was leading the salah, he sensed that Rasulullah is coming from behind with the support of two people. And he sensed that in the salah, and he began moving back from the musalla. He began moving back. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam motioned him with his hand to stay where he was. But he actually moved back. After the salah, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called him and asked him as to why he was moving backwards in his salah. He should have stayed where he was. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu said, O Nabi of Allah, I perceive that you are coming forward, and it does not behold me. It does not behold the personality of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu that I lead the salah and the Nabi of Allah is behind me. How can I do that? That I lead the salah and the Nabi of Allah is behind me. MashaAllah, today you have scholars in sometimes in the masjid and so on, and people jump and they lead the salah. Out of no respect. Huh? So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu said, Ya Rasulullah, it does not fit my personality that you are here and I lead the salah. Huh? There was a man by the name of Bishop in the past. Once he came out of his house drunk. He came out of his house drunk. And his eyes, it was raining. So his eyes caught hold of a piece of paper lying in the mud. Lying in the mud. As he went closer, he looked at the paper and he saw that the name Allah was written on this paper. So he decided to pick this paper up. He cleaned it and he put it in his house in a very high place. He's showing respect to the name of Allah, right? Today, people take qasam in the name of Allah and speak lies. Wallahi, tallahi, billahi, and it's lie. You know? He saw this piece of paper and he picked it up. A drunk man, drunk, in a state of intoxication. He recognized the azmat and the greatness of this word Allah. And he picked it up and he cleaned that paper and he put it high in his house. After a while, he saw in a dream. And it was told to him in this dream, because you raise the name of Allah, Allah will raise your name in this dunya and in akhirah. Because you raise the name of Allah, Allah will raise you up in dunya and in akhirah. Later on, he became one of the saints of his time, and he was well known by everyone. Look how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala elevated his name. We have elderly people around us, right? A lot of elderly people. Today, who gives respect to the elderly? Who gives respect to the elderly? You would find that very rare among the generation of today. And sometimes you see it in your own homes. How your children speak to you. Do they speak to you with respect? Proper respect? No. Some may not. If you have children like that, that speaks to you respectfully, cherish them. Really cherish them. Because the generation now and the generation is coming, it's getting worse. Sayyidina Anas radiallahu anhu said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if a young man respects an elderly person because of his age, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will appoint someone later on in his life to respect him because of his old age. You respect someone because of his age. Allah will appoint someone to respect you when you become old.
Why? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam here, he is advising the youth of society that, you know, you will one day become old and elderly, and you would need people to respect you. So if you want people to respect you, then you need to give that respect. The Hadith al-Qudsi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about the elderly, you know, I will not quote every length of it, I will quote from 60 years. إِذَا بَلَغَ عَبْدِي When my servant reaches 60 years in my service, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that he now becomes my, I change his direction now towards me. I change his direction from the dunya now towards me, towards Allah. He's now more inclined towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. His attachment should get lesser when it comes to the worldly life, and his attachment should get more when it comes to deen. وَإِذَا بَلَغَ عَبْدِي When my servant reached 70 sana, 70 years, I make him my beloved. I make him my beloved. He becomes beloved in the earth and in the skies. All the creation in the sky starts loving him. Why? He is 70 years old in my obedience. Wow! Huh? And when my servant reaches 80 years, إِذَا بَلَغَ عَبْدِي 80 sana, When my servant reaches 80 years, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that I do not even write his small mistakes that he commits. The small mistakes that he commits is not even written down. 80 years in my obedience. And when my servant reaches 90 years Allah gives someone to live in this world, serving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he becomes the guest of Allah on earth. He becomes what? The guest of Allah on earth. Rasulullah said on the day of Qiyamah, the family of this man will be in front of him. This 90-year-old man, his family will be in front of him. And whomsoever he point his finger towards, they will go to Jannah. Whomsoever he point his finger towards, everyone he pointed his finger towards, Allah will put every one of them in Jannah. How many people respect the elderly today because of their age? How many? Huh? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Be merciful to all people, Muslim as well as non-Muslim. Be merciful to all people. Where does Islam say, but killing is okay? Huh? Destroying people's life is okay. Here the Nabi of Allah is telling us, be merciful to all people, Muslim as well as non-Muslim. Be merciful to them. Be merciful. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, who should give salam first? If you have the young and the old, what is the adab of salam? The young should greet the elderly, right? The young should greet the elderly. Inna min ijlalillahi ta'ala. It is the demand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we respect the elderly. We respect the elderly. Once someone was driving in a car, you know, he was driving and it was a scholar who was going in with him together in the car, and it was another person. So the scholar told the other person, please sit in front and I will sit at the back. The person said, no, no, I would not sit behind. I would not sit in front and you behind, because you are Allah bless you with ilm. Allah bless you with knowledge. You carry the ilm of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in your heart. How dear I can sit in front and you sit behind. This is respect. This is mannerism, my dear respected brothers and elders. Huh? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, hadith comes in Muslim, huh? That I saw in a dream, فَجَاءَنِي رَجُلَانِ Two people came to me in a dream, and I was doing miswak, I was doing siwak, and one was a little bit younger than the other one, right? So I took the miswak and give it to the younger one. Rasulullah said, I did this in a dream. I took the miswak and give it to the younger one. And someone told me in the dream, Kabbir, 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 Kabbir. Give it to the elderly one first. Give it to the one that is elderly first. Because his right, recognize his right. So what is the level of respect today? What is the level of respect among us? What is the level of respect between husband and wives? Do we have that respect among ourselves? Huh? And lastly, I would mention, because of time constraint, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَنَزَعْنَا مَا فِي صُدُورِهِمْ مِنْ غِلْ Before a person will be placed in Jannah, and Allah will place all of us, say Ameen.
Before Allah will place us in the Jannah, Allah will take out malice and enmity and hasad from our hearts. So our hearts will be pure and clean. We will see people having in'amat and blessings of Allah, and we will not envy them. We will not envy them. Today, you know, what do people say about the imams, the four imams, the a'imma arba? Their vision, what were their vision? What were their vision? There was a hidden agenda. There was a hidden agenda where people say, don't follow the madhahib. Follow Quran and Sunnah. What do these people are telling us? Are they not telling us Quran and Sunnah? They are telling us Quran and Sunnah. So there are a hidden agenda that is trying to divert us from this. Look at the respect these four a'imma even had among themselves. Imam Shafi'i rahmatullahi alayhi, the great, the giant Imam Shafi'i, he came to visit the grave of Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi. Imam al-A'zam, Imam Abu Hanifa, he came to visit him. And he stood by the grave of Imam Abu Hanifa and he recited Quran. Right? And then he stayed there for a while and he performed Salat al-Fajr the next day in the location of Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi. And we know that according to the madhab of Imam Shafi'i, you recite Qurut and Fajr, don't you? You recite Qurut and Fajr according to the madhab of Imam Shafi'i. But Imam Shafi'i rahmatullahi alayhi said, in this Fajr, I will not recite Qurut. Why? In respect of Imam Abu Hanifa's madhab. In respect of Imam Abu Hanifa's madhab, today I will not recite Qunut and Fajr. That's the respect they have with each other. And today, we divert them, we destroy them. We destroy the A'imma Arba. They had respect for each other. We who don't have no ilm whatsoever, no knowledge whatsoever, spreading propaganda, hidden agenda, saying no, there's no A'imma Arba, you know. And what do we do? When they had respect for themselves, who are we to disrespect them? Who are we to disrespect them? So the sha'air of Allah, we must respect the sha'air of Allah. Have respect and mannerism in your life. We need to respect each and every individual. Allah, His Nabi, His Sahaba, your colleagues, your friend, Muslim, non-Muslim. What's your relationship with your spouse at home? Husband and wife relationship. Respect each other. When respect is there, you will see a different phase of your life, inshallah. Life will become better. And you will climb a different height in life, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us true respect for Allah, for His Nabi, for each other. And self-esteem is something we should adopt in life. Have respect for yourself. Have respect for this deen that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to us. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillah.